In our study of the Gospel according to John, we still have work to do in plumbing the riches of God's grace in John chapter 1 from verse 32 to 34. And John bore witness, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and he remained upon him. I did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I have seen and testified that this is the Son of God.
That I might know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, that I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead, that I might apprehend that which I've been apprehended for.
The Old Testament prophets spoke of a time in the restoration of Israel where the Spirit would be poured out on God's chosen people. The prophet Ezekiel had a vivid vision in Ezekiel chapter 37 from verse 1 to 11 that captures this expectation. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by his Spirit and set me down in the middle of a valley, and it was full of bones. He led me all around among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, and indeed they were very dry. Then he asked me, Son of man, can these bones come to life? O Lord God, I replied, only you know. And he said to me, prophesy concerning these bones, and tell them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Lord God says to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you, and make flesh grow upon you, and cover you with skin. I will put breath within you, so that you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I had been commanded. And as I prophesied, there was suddenly a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to bone. As I looked on, tendons appeared on them, flesh grew, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and tell the breath that this is what the Lord God says. Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into this slain, so that they may live. So I prophesied as he had commanded me, and the breath entered them, and they came to life, and stood on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Look! They are saying, our bones are dried up, and our hope has perished. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and tell them that this is what the Lord God says. O my people, I will open your graves and bring you up from them, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them, I will put my Spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I will do it, declares the Lord. The Holy Spirit, brought out in the restoration of Israel, as foretold by Ezekiel, will bring refreshing to the people of God. This spirit is a life-giving spirit. It causes life to return to every death and decaying condition of the spirit, soul, and body of man. Where the people said, "Our bones are dried up and our hope has perished, we are cut off," God is saying, "Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them, I will put my spirit in you and you will live." So John the Baptist proclaims that God, the Father, said to him, "Upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit." He says in Matthew 3 verse 11, "I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me will come one more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire." The baptizer with the Holy Ghost and fire is the Lord from heaven, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The baptism with the Holy Ghost will fill the soul of the believer with a life-transforming spirit, which will be in the believer a well of living water that will continue to spring everlasting life. This Holy Spirit is the source of life and holiness and wisdom. The baptism with fire will fill the believer's soul with the consuming fire of the holiness of God. It will purify and totally purge the evil and wash what was precious to be even brighter. At the baptism of Jesus Christ by John the Baptist, the Holy Spirit descended like a dove and rested on Jesus. In Matthew 3 verse 13 to 16, it reads, "At that time, Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. But John tried to prevent him, saying, 'I need to be baptized by you. And do you come to me?' 'Let it be so for now,' Jesus replied. 'It is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness in this way.' Then John permitted him. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. Suddenly the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and resting on him. And a voice from heaven said, 'This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.'" John the Baptist was initially reluctant to baptize Jesus because he recognized that Jesus had no need for repentance. But in order for all righteousness to be fulfilled, Jesus had to be identified with his people as the bearer of their sins. Isaiah 53 verse 12 says that he was numbered with the transgressors, yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Ultimately, John's baptism for repentance of sins points to Jesus, because only the death of Jesus on the cross can take away sins. And Jesus calls his death a baptism. In Luke chapter 12 from verse 49 to 50, Jesus says, "I have come to ignite a fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled, but I have a baptism to undergo, and how distressed I am until it is accomplished." At this point, I want to say that it is incredibly important that believers know who the person of the Holy Spirit is and understand his work, especially as it relates to our salvation. Remember that God is one in essence and three in person. These persons are distinct characters, but one God. And the difference between the Father, Yahweh, the Son, Yahshua HaMashiach, and the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, are real differences, but not essential differences. That is to say that there is only one essence to the Godhead and not three. The Father is God, the Son is God, and the Spirit is God. But the Father is not the Son or Spirit. The Son is not the Father or Spirit. And the Spirit is not the Father or Son. This is the heart of our faith and the confession of the church throughout all ages. The Trinity is a doctrine that we cannot fully understand in the hic et nunc, in the here and the now, because of the limitations of our finitude and the majesty and greatness of God Himself. But we do not need to fully understand it in order to affirm it. It is taught in God's Word, and we are responsible to believe what God's Word teaches, even when complete comprehension escapes us. Contrary to the assertions of Islam and other religions, this is not a contradiction. If God were to be one and not one, that is to say, if God were to be one and three at the same time and in the same relationship, then we would have a logical contradiction. For example, if we were to say that God is one in essence and not one in essence, then we would be confessing nonsense. But we believe that God is one and God is three at the same time, but the way in which He is one in essence is different from the way in which He is three in person. To be sure, this doctrine is mysterious and we cannot fully understand it. Yet that does not mean that it is illogical. The fact that the Holy Spirit is a person is seen throughout Scripture. But one of the primary evidences is that the Bible repeatedly and consistently uses personal pronouns to refer to Him. He is called He, Him, and so on, not it. Also, He does things that we associate with personality. He teaches, He inspires, He guides, He leads, He grieves, He convicts us of sin, and much more. Impersonal objects do not have these qualities. And while the Holy Spirit is a person, He is also fully divine as God. So we refer to the Spirit of God, or God's Spirit, or simply the Spirit, as God, the Holy Spirit. This is the Holy Spirit that will dwell within us and is working in us to conform us to Christ. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 13, and in Him, having heard and believed the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. This Holy Spirit that is with us and in us is the very God Himself, to whom we worship, and to whom be glory and honor and power and blessing and praise and strength for all eternity. So we will close with the apostolic benediction from 2 Corinthians 13 verse 14. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. At this point, I want to pray a prayer to God. What I want to say to Him is to know Him. To know Him is the cry of my heart. Spirit, reveal Him to me. To hear what He says brings life to my bones. To know Him. To know Him alone.
I know Him and the power of His resurrection. and the fellowship of his suffering, being conformed unto his death, that I might apprehend that which I've been apprehended for. Apprehended for being conformed unto his death, that I might apprehend that which I've been apprehended for. That which I've been apprehended for.